Like our God. I don't care what the culture says. Don't care what the nations say. There's only one true God. There's only one wise God. He alone is worthy of the praise and the honor. He alone gave his life, his life's blood. There is only one that is living and true. So we sing this song to him. No one like our God.
There is no one.
Amen, 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 amen. Amen, amen. More than anything, and I can say this for our pastor, I'm sure, more than anything, we desperately need to know that the presence of God is in the house. We desperately need his wisdom and his guidance. We desperately need him to manifest and have his way. As you sing this song, don't just sing it because it's a song. But the Spirit of God is present. Hallelujah.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence I've tasted of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome.
Come flood this.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaken. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've built my life on Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. He won't. He won't fail. Is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaken. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. Rain came and wind blew, but my house was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through. Rain came and wind blew, but my house was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through. Rain came and wind blew, but my house was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through. Yeah, through, 'cause I'm standing strong on you. Oh, I'm gonna make it through, 'cause my house was built on you. Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful in every iteration, so why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't.
Father, we thank you that you will never fail. And Lord, we just ask that each person that is here this morning would be touched by the presence of your Holy Spirit and the power of your word. Lord, that you would hover over this place as you did at creation, and your word would bring life. In Jesus' name, amen. Luke chapter 10, beginning with verse 21, I want to talk to you about having higher vision. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced in the Spirit, and he said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and the prudent, but revealed them to babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight. All things have been delivered to me by my Father. No one knows who the Son is except the Father, and who the Father is except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him." And he turned to his disciples and said privately, "Blessed are the eyes which see the things that you see. For I tell you, many prophets and kings have desired to see and hear and have not seen it, and to hear what you've heard and have not heard it." Hallelujah. Jesus is saying to his disciples, you've been given spiritual vision. And that first line, you know, people always portray Jesus as somber and stiff and sober. If that was the case, children would not have ran to him like they did. That word there, Jesus rejoiced in the Spirit, in the Greek, agalaeo, do you know what it means? It means to leap for joy. Can you imagine that? Now some of the folks, you know, why do you guys get so crazy and wild? I don't think we get crazy enough. I think we need to praise and worship with all of our hearts. The Bible talks about shouting, dancing, lifting your hands, jumping for joy. Jesus said, when they speak all manner of evil against you, rejoice in what? Leap for joy. Remember that lame man that got healed? He went into the temple leaping and shouting and dancing and praising God. The devil wants church to be dull and boring and dry. Now, some of y'all acted more like you believed in the ball game you watched the other night, even though it didn't end right, than you do when you get to church, but I'll leave that alone. Higher vision. I'm telling you, I have learned the hard way that focus is everything about the condition of my spirit and even my moods and depression and anxiety. It's what am I focusing on? And Jesus says, you've seen some precious things. Aren't you glad you know who Jesus is? Aren't you glad that through the Holy Spirit you've been drawn to him and you realize that Jesus is the express image of the Father and he portrays the Father perfectly, and the Holy Spirit within you, hallelujah, reveals Jesus to you? Isn't that awesome? Everybody don't have that. And so when I was thinking about higher vision, I'm thinking of an Old Testament story of Abram and Lot. He later becomes Abraham. God changes his name, combines it with his name, with God's name. But Abraham takes Lot, his nephew, with him on his quest, and he loves his nephew. His nephew is like a son to him. But in the process of time, because Abram's been so good to him, Lot's herds begin to increase, and Abram's herds are increasing, and the herdsmen get in fights with each other about who gets the best pasture. It's in your Bible. And Abram calls Lot to him. And he said, "Let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, between my herdsmen and thy herdsmen, for we are brethren. Is not the whole land before you? If you choose the left, I'll go to the right. If you choose the right, I'll go to the left. I'm giving you the choice." Anybody here ever been really good to a relative just to get betrayed by them? Has anybody ever been betrayed by a loved one? Here is a man who has done everything he can to make sure that Lot is prosperous and successful, and he gives Lot a choice. And you know what Lot does? Lot chooses all of the well-watered pasture and leaves Abram with a rocky mountainside. That's not very generous, is it? But I'm going to tell you something. I want you to hear this. Because of the call on Abram's life, he thought more of love and peace and grace in his family than he did about just possessions. And I want you to notice what God said to him. Remember, I told you that you could see things if you would just look up. And the Lord said to Abram, Genesis 13, 14, after Lot had separated from him, "Lift up now and look from the place where you are." Somebody in the house needs to lift up your eyes and look from the depression, the situation, the problem, the sickness, wherever you are right now. You need to look a little higher. God's got something for you to see. Lift up your eyes. Northward, southward, eastward, and westward. All the land which you see, I will give to you and your descendants forever. I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth. So if a man should number the dust of the earth, so will your descendants be numbered. Arise and walk in the land through its length and through its width, for I give it to you. Wow. Folks, you can have a word from God. And I tell you what, things are getting crazy in the world, but look a little higher. Now, because of this higher vision and this selflessness, Abram prospers. Because of Lot's selfish decision, he keeps camping closer and closer to Sodom until he winds up becoming part of it. There's a battle, 4 kings against 5, and Sodom and Gomorrah are defeated, and the other kings, and they take them all captive. And somebody brings Abram word that his nephew Lot has been captured with his house. Now, and I tell you what I probably would have said, don't be too hard on me. That's what he gets. You make your bed, you lay in it. See, that's what you get for. But you know, that's not Abram's attitude. Abram takes his 318 servants that can be armed and goes against 5 kings. The good news is the kings think that there's nobody left to whip them, and all their armies have been partying and they're all drunk. People really never change, just names. Abram shows up, encircles the camp, blows trumpets and attacks, and has a complete victory and liberates the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah along with Lot and his family. And I'm going to tell you what God did. There's a character that shows up in this story. There's 2 kings in this story. One is Bera, the king of Sodom, and he offers to Abraham wealth and fame to make him rich. Sodom means perversion. We wouldn't know about that in today's world, would we? I say sarcastically, obviously. On the other hand, there's this king that the Bible says in the book of Hebrews has neither beginning or end of days, no father, mother, no descent. And his name is Melchizedek, which means king of righteousness, king of peace. Jesus shows up in the Old Testament for Abram because Abram is willing to go the extra mile. And he has communion with the king of righteousness. Amen. Check it out, Genesis 14, Hebrews 7. Read the story. Listen, if you'll have higher vision, you can commune with Jesus. I want to challenge you. If you've been betrayed by somebody, do some good for evil. Watch what God will do for you. Lord, help us. The second portion of scripture I want to take your attention to is also in the book of Genesis. And Abraham made his mistakes, didn't he? By the handmaiden Hagar, at his wife's request, Ishmael is born. Ishmael and Hagar are sent on a journey to a new land. They run out of water. They run out of food. The heat is intense in the desert. She lays little Ishmael, her son, under a bush waiting for him to die. But she cries out to the Lord. And the lad, the child, cries out to God. Are you concerned about, how many is concerned about some loved ones, some children, some grandchildren? I'm telling you, folks, we're going to see God do some amazing things. Genesis 21, 17. God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of the Lord called to Hagar out of heaven and said, "What ails you, Hagar? Fear not." Everybody say, "Fear not." I'm going to tell you something. That phrase, in one way or another, is in your Bible exactly 365 times, one for every day of the year. Isn't that incredible? Fear not. God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise. Hallelujah. Lift up the lad and hold him in your hand, and I will make of him a great nation. Notice this. God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. And she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad drink. And God was with the lad, and he grew and dwelt in the wilderness and became a great archer. That's a bow hunter for us West Virginians. Amen. God heard his voice. And he said, "Hagar, you're looking at the ground. You're looking at the dirt." My mama used to say, two men stood behind prison bars. One saw only mud, but the other saw the stars. Where's your vision? This isn't in my notes or plans, but I want to stop right now and pray for our loved ones that need miracles. Amen. How many have them? Raise your hands. Let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, we're asking for our children, for our grandchildren, for our loved ones, for those who are dear to our hearts, that they cry out to you and you hear their voice and you supply them with living water. And we're going to thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. And then when we go to the book of 2 Kings, anybody in the house ever feel surrounded by enemies, that every way you turn, something's negative? Did you ever feel that way? I sure do sometimes. Amen. Here's the story. Elisha the prophet, every time the king that brings attacks against Israel, every time they come to attack, God tells the prophet where they're coming and how they're going to attack and where their ambushes are. He relays that to the king, and God gives Israel victory. And so the king decides, "I'm going to get an army and I'm going to go after that guy that's telling all these secrets," because he said, "What is it? Is this a bird in the chamber giving the message?" They said, "No, there's a man of God over there that hears from God." And so all of a sudden, the Syrian army encircles the little town of Dothan, the little village where Elisha and his servant are staying. And they send a great army to take him captive. Therefore, 2 Kings 6:14, he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God arose early in the morning and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And the servant said to him, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" So he answered, there it is again, you see it? "Do not fear." I want you to notice Elisha's not even concerned and upset. Lord, help us to have the kind of faith that Elisha had. "Do not fear, those, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountains was full of horses and chariots of fire all around them. This is what I want you to get out of this. When the enemy surrounds you, God's angels surround the enemy.
Amen.
And he's the one in the trap. Yeah. Hallelujah. I read a story of an old revivalist from the early 1900s that was having great miracles and wonderful things happening in his meetings. And one night he fell asleep and he awakened to a strange presence in the room and a glow. And there was a manifestation of Satan himself in his room. Smith said, "Oh, it's only you." And he rolled over and went back to sleep. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Hallelujah. So when you're surrounded by enemies, just ask the Lord to open your eyes. Remember that old song, "Open the eyes of my heart, Lord"? I'm talking about spiritual vision. Now, come over to the New Testament with me. Jesus has been crucified. He's been buried. It's after 3 days now. Everybody doesn't know that he has risen again. And there's a couple gentlemen walking on the road to Emmaus. And Jesus shows up and they don't recognize him. Bible says their eyes were holding, that they did not know him. Well, last time they saw him, he was ripped to shreds in a dead body. So think about that. So it was. The Bible says he began in the beginning at Moses and showed him all the prophecies about himself in the Old Testament. Isn't that incredible? Wouldn't you like to have been walking along with that and heard Jesus himself share all that? So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were restrained, so they did not know him. And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them, and their eyes were open, and they knew him. God, let somebody's eyes be opened in the house this morning that they can know you, that they can recognize you. Listen, I'm breaking the bread of life right now. See Christ in it. He vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us on the road, while he opened to them the scriptures?" You notice it. Whenever they broke bread, their culture, they said like this, "Blessed art thou, King of the universe, that bringeth forth bread from the earth." You know what they saw when he did that? Nail-scarred hands that were pierced for their salvation. I want you to know he can still be recognized by the breaking of the bread, and what he did is for you. Lord, open our eyes today in the day that we live in. Hebrews 12, 2 through 3, looking unto Jesus. Where's your focus? I know there's an election coming up. I know there's a mess in this nation. And I want to say to all of you here, if you're not registered to vote and you don't vote, then don't go to bellyaching about how it went. I might get in trouble here, but don't vote personality, vote policy. Be careful of folks that endorse the mutilating of little children, trying to make little boys into little girls and little girls into little boys. That's not scientific and that's not safe. Be careful of those that endorse all the craziness. Amen. I'm going to move on. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Amen. Look to him. Now this is a picture of the arena where the victors from before would be seated near the emperor with the crown of victory on their heads, encouraging those still in the fight. And I want you to know that all the heroes of the Old Testament, if you'll read the 11th chapter, are saying, "Come on, you can make it." Noah said, "If I could make it in my day, you can make it in your day." Amen. Abraham says you can make it. David says you can make it. Daniel says, "If I can praise him in the lion's den, you can make it." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego say, "If he appeared with us in the fire, he'll go through the fire with you." I don't have time to talk about all of them, but you can make it. What's our day described like? Luke 21, 24. Many will fall by the edge of the sword and led away captive into all nations. Jerusalem will be trampled by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. Now this prophecy has already been fulfilled. Israel was scattered all over the world. They've been gathered back into their nation. And just 50 years after they became a nation again in 48, they were recognized. Jerusalem was recognized as the capital of Israel. Our day's about up. Do you see it? Until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Do you see the army surrounding Jerusalem again? Are you watching what's happening? There will be signs in the sun and the moon and in the stars, and on the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, sea and waves roaring, men's hearts failing them from fear with the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to happen, get you some dried beans and go hide in a cave. That's what I'm hearing. I'm seeing preachers on TV make merchandise of people telling them just, oh, store up. It's okay to prepare for hard times. Don't misunderstand me. But I'm telling you, the closer we get to the return of Jesus, the more we ought to be reaching out to the lost. When you see these things begin to happen, what does he say? Say it with me. Look up. Lift up your heads. Your redemption draweth nigh. Give him praise in the house. My wife came to me one time and she said, the reason you're struggling with anxiety is you watch the news too much. Don't you hate to admit when they're right, gentlemen? And I realized that my focus was more on what the devil was doing here than what God's preparing to do. But I'm telling you, no matter how things go, there's going to be a trumpet sound. There's going to be a resurrection and a rapture of the church. Hallelujah. We're going to reign with him for 1,000 years. We are his children. He's prepared for us a kingdom. I'll get it out here right in a minute. Amen. Aren't you glad? So what should we be doing? I'm glad you ask. Don't say, John 14, 35 and 36, 4 months and then comes the harvest. Behold, I say to you, here it is again, lift up your eyes and look. Say that with me. Lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white unto harvest. He who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life. Now both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. Hallelujah. So this week and today at the courthouse, City Park, whatever you face, whether it's somebody betraying you like Abraham, whether it's concern about a loved one like Hagar, come on, whether you feel surrounded by enemies like Elisha and his servant, look up. Lift up your heads. Rejoice. Redemption draws nigh. I want you to stand with me. These altars are open. If you don't know Jesus, this would be a good day for you to come to the Lord, because he is coming soon.
The splendor of the King. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. And all The lion.